people lift their hat and see Hammer and them 357 bitches. Biggie Small, the millionaire, the mansion, the yacht, the two weak spots, the two hot blocks. That's how I got the weak spot. I shot Dredd in the head, took the bread and the lamb spread. Little Benny got the shot into your body, so don't resist or you might miss Christmas. I tote guns, I make number runs, I give MCs the runs dripping. When I throw my clip in the AK, I slay from far away. Everybody hit the DECK. My slow flow's remarkable. Peace to Mateo. Now we smoke weed like Tony Montana, sniff the yayo. That's crazy blunts, bad hills, my voice exhales from the avenue to tail cells. Oh my god, I'm dropping shit like a pigeon. I hope you're listening, smacking babies at their christening.
What up, what up? We are here. It is Masters Week. I couldn't be more excited. I'm not really going to talk about previous tournaments. We're going to keep it focused on this week, the Masters. You know, probably the best week of the year as a golf fan. Probably the week that the, you know, players look forward to the most. And one that I'm, you know, couldn't be more excited for. There's a bunch of million-dollar competitions on DraftKings. I think there's four Millie Makers they're doing. Or there's at least three, excuse me. I will not be doing the 4-4-4-4. If I didn't do well in that, I wouldn't be happy with myself. And that's just a sickening amount of money per lineup. So for those people, good luck. That's a way smaller pool size. It's like 600 people. I'm going to do about 15 entries into the $100 entry Millie Maker, which is about 20,000 people. So I'll have 15 shots there, which I'm excited about. You know, 15 out of 29,000 versus I think we did 50 out of like 150,000 at the Players. And we came top 150 at the Players without the winner. So we are excited for kind of that opportunity with that contest. However, I've also got another 50 lineups entered into the $15 entry, which is, you know, out of 350,000, which is basically the lottery, you know, to a certain extent, right? I mean, I think that there's ways we can create leverage and things along those lines in a 350,000 person competition. But at the same time, it's the biggest number of entries DraftKings does every year for a single contest in the golf world. So it's the toughest, meaning it's the toughest competition to win. It's a million the first, 250 to second, which is nice. You know, they made that big drop down. Typically it's a million to first and then 100K to second. I think that's what it is for the other competitions actually. So, those are just competition structures. I would, you know, as somebody who does this every week, and this is a great week to do it. If you're trying to, like, you know, get in for the first time, this is like one of the most intense weeks to do it. I always say, if you're gonna do it, you should do 10 entries, and you should do it in the $5 competition. This week, the $5 competition is for $100,000. And it's out of 150,000 entries. It's a great structure. I'm just a sicko and I'm chasing $1 million. So I entered that one instead. And I think when you do the math out, that like the payout structure is better than the $15 one. But yeah, I'm chasing $1 million this week. So that's the goal. We're gonna chase $1 million. And you know what we'll do on the show here today is this is a week where I've done both outrights and lineups. And again, I haven't locked anything into lineups yet. I'm getting close now that it's Wednesday to start kind of building. I already have an idea of who I like and kind of a strategy I'm gonna deploy. And we'll get into all of that on the show here, but first things first, let's just talk about the course in general and how I think the course is going to play. And then we will look at the player prices. We'll talk about, you know, quickly the outrights, who I'm liking, and then the DraftKings plays. So try to try to do the show in under an hour today. I want to give a little more juice today, just because it's a bigger week. At the same time, I think for this week, there's so much content out there, and it's the only major that's at the same course every year. So you'll get a lot of repetitiveness in terms of what people are saying, I'm sure, or what I'm saying on this show. If you listened to another show to a certain extent, you'd hear a lot of the same things, just because, again, people know this course so well. People know the types of players that play well here and things along those lines. So it's not meant to say that we shouldn't talk about it, but some people, I'm sure, you know, who have been researching or whatever, at this point, are like, oh, there's just another, you know, this is just another podcast or whatever this week. But we'll try to add more value to it. I think I will, in terms of talking about some of the strategy and actual plays. So let's dive into it. So the course itself, Augusta National Golf Club, and it typically plays, 7,476 yards, par 72, 6,486 average green size, bent grass greens, highest correlated stats to success tend to be eagles, birdie or better, bounce back or purchase from 225, driving distance, going for green, par four or better, putting average, par breakers. So all of this, I think makes sense. Sorry for, let me speak English now. Augusta National is a long, it's one of the longer courses that these players will play, and it's been extended. So 7476 is what I've been seeing on a lot of different, or 7-4, whatever it's been on a different website. I think it's actually going to act, when it comes down to what they'll see on the scorecard, is going to be 7,500 plus. So it's typically a course where driving distance weighs, has a premium over driving accuracy. They're long, wide fairways. And it's like also a course, like if you think about from that perspective, that they're forgiving fairways, where guys who spray the ball a little have had more success. Spieth and Cam Smith and Leishman are three guys I always point to, where they kind of spray the ball off the tee, but the rest of their game is, very well-rounded, and they've had success, here because of it. Good drivers do well, also do well. That's not to say, we shouldn't be targeting good drivers. I think we should, but it is something to think about that, this guy, if you're thinking like I was thinking at the players, which was wrong, but like, I'm not going to take Cam Smith because he's sporadic off the tee. The course is surrounded by water and all of that, and there'll be penalties. This course is way less forgiving. So if you're sporadic off the tee, like it'll be penalizing, but not nearly as penalizing as a lot of the other courses these guys play. Where it gets very penalizing is when you don't hit the green, when you're not on the green in regulation. So that's because this course is undulated. It's one of the, toughest walks. You'll hear that all the time this week, and they'll talk about that with Tiger. And I will say that from people I've talked to that have done the walk, if you hear the players talk about it as well, it does make a difference. So it's something that's, worth noting if, like, you're thinking about taking Tiger, for example. But we'll get into, player by player stuff here shortly. So the other thing I wanted to talk about, and this is like, I nailed this strategy for the players. I knocked it out of the park. I've talked about it. I've brushed my shoulders off or whatever. It didn't really make me any money, which sucks, but felt good to at least nail the game theory at the players and be in it for the $1 million until basically the back nine on Sunday. I think there's going to be a slight weather advantage this week. I don't think it's going to be as extenuated as it was at the players, but like, I'm looking at the weather right now. Like, to me, it looks like the PM, AM tee times will have, like, PM, AM group, in terms of they go off in the afternoon Thursday and then they go off in the morning Friday. It looks like they're going to have an advantage. And like, this is something, and I'm gonna play into this. I'm gonna play the PMAM wave, especially in a 350,000 person competition where there's gonna be like, that's gonna create some leverage in itself. I have a feeling that this this other people are more onto this than they were at the players. And I think for some reason the narrative that came up at the players, I just think like was wrong, and like on Twitter and all of that. And you know, I could be wrong again here, but I think the one that's being developed in terms of what people are looking at is right, because I've been listening to a lot of people that say, you know, PMAM wave, there could be, you know, advantage too. And the PM group, the group that would go off in the PM day one, the highest wind I'm looking at, they would see is 13 miles per hour. And that's pretty steady, right? It's staying at like, it's 8 to 13 throughout the day on Thursday. Whereas Friday, when they tee off in the morning, it's going to be 6. And it's going to be as high as 19 when they're on a course. And when it's 19 or even when it's 15 the day before or whatever, like assume that there's going to be, the gust can get up to 10 higher. So if it's 19 or 20 on Friday, they could be seeing gusts of 30. And right, that's where Augusta is, you know, it's going to play like a beast. And some people have talked about this, some people haven't. I think more people will talk about it today on shows that come out. The weather, like, it just doesn't look good. I mean, it you know, windy Thursday, windy Friday, windy Saturday, and then Sunday is the nicest day. They also had like tornado warnings yesterday. It apparently biblical quote unquote rains. So all stuff important to think about. And this is where I'll, to maybe the more casual fan of golf, they might not be thinking about, but think about it from this perspective. So course has been extended to 7,500 yards, right? Some of the toughest holes, I think it's 15. I wrote this down somewhere. 18 has been slightly extended. 11 was lengthened. 11, 15, and 18 were lengthened. So, and two of those are Amen Corner. And, you know, coming down the stretch, finishing, and they were talking to some players about, you know, will it make a difference? And, you know, I think it was Morikawa who said basically like, yeah, I mean, the difference between hitting a 6-iron into the green, you know, and, you know, with the wind in your face versus a 4 is going to make players, you know, think, especially coming down the stretch, you know, to put on a green jacket. So just things to consider. I think the distance, I don't know if it's driving distance. I don't think it's driving distance as much as people will say, but I think that guys who hit long irons well or are going to be in the fairway, you know, hitting long irons are going to have, you know, more success than guys that are sporadic off the tee here, and are like trying to recover. And that's not to say they can't go that route, but just with everything, the weather and all of that, I just think, you know, that's going to be the easier path to victory. So, I think like a guy like Colin. Well, I'll wait. Let me let me finish this the course stuff. Is that all I got on the course? Oh no, the one thing. Yeah. So what I wanted to say about the course is the last thing I wanted to say, that, you know, that people maybe that kept more casual fan isn't necessarily thinking about. So if it's been extended, right? Some of these biggest holes, it's going to play 7,500 yards, par 72. That's a long course. And now it's pouring. So two things before I say it's pouring down rain. Spieth was quoted, and a lot of the players have been quoted saying the course is playing firm and faster than it ever has since Spieth's been there. So Spieth played in 5 Masters. So this is 6 Masters. So in 6 years, he hasn't seen it play this firm and fast. And this quote was at the beginning of the week. So the course was playing extremely firm and fast. Now that it's biblical rains, that will slow the course down to a certain extent. The Augusta National is like one of the best golf courses in the world, if not the best golf course in the world. So they have the drainage, they have all of the systems to make the course pristine, regardless of what rain or, you know, does or doesn't happen. With that being said, I still think that the course will slow down a little bit because of this wind, because of this rain for Thursday. With whipping winds and no more rain after today, the course should dry out pretty quickly. I think by Friday, and this is back. This is part of where I see the weather and just the course, like the way the course is going to change, helping the PM wave. I think with all the wind, like the course is going to be firming up very quickly. So Thursday, I think it's going to start a little slower. And then Friday, I think it's going to be firm and fast. I think that's where it's going to be scary for the guys who are playing it when it's firm and fast. And it's 20 mile per hour winds with gusts up to 30. So that's where I am leaning with the overall strategy. There's a few guys I bet that I bet before the tee times came off, and I'm not as happy that I bet them now, but whatever, you know, I don't think this is, you know, make or break, but I do think if you're playing lineups this week, if you're playing lineups especially, lean PMAM. Meaning if you're between two guys, I think like you should look towards guys who are gonna be teeing off in the PM. So let's get into the players. Let's get into the board. Quickly, the guys I bet outright. I'll tell you the ones that I really like, and then the ones that I like less just because of the tee time. So I really like DJ this week. And there's a lot of reasons why, but here's my quick sell, I guess. He's played in 11 tournaments. He's played in 11 Masters. He's got 6 top 20s. He's got 5 top 10s. He's got a win and a runner-up. 40 rounds played, 21 under par. More than 50% of his rounds in Augusta are under par. He's made 9 cuts. So, Augusta profile, perfect. Form, perfect. Not perfect, but form coming into this Masters is the best his form has been in a long time. And I said to people, I think it's going to be a big year for DJ. And he had not that great of a year last year. People maybe forget 2 years ago, he won like every tournament he played in, the year he won the Masters. So, look, he looks hungry. He looks scary. He was excited for Hideki's Masters dinner, which, you know, you can't factor into the model, but should be weighed to a certain extent. Love seeing DJ with a smile on his face. And it's just a certain feel thing. When he won the Masters a few years ago, it was probably like the longest I called something other than like Morikawa at the PGA, but I was just like, I had this feeling that DJ was going to win. So I have the same feeling, you know, I could be wrong. But just what he's been doing lately from the last round of the Players to the match play, and I don't think a lot of people are on him from what I'm seeing from ownership projections. 10.5% is where I'm projecting him to be finally, and I love that. So he's my number one DraftKings play. He's my biggest outright bet, and he's PMAM in terms of his wave. And on top of all of that, what I just said there, he also nails the ball tee to green. And like I said, I think that distance, not necessarily driving distance, but tee to green, because Morikawa is another guy who gets the ball tee to green incredibly well. He doesn't hit the ball as far as DJ off the tee, but his irons are so good that he catches up to him, you know, from that perspective. So, but point being, DJ can play these long courses well. So everything in my mind is pointing towards DJ, and sometimes things that scare me are like him being chalky. He's not chalky. I like everything about it this week. So DJ is, again, my number one bet guy, number one DraftKings play. And he, 10.5% ownership. If he's 10% ownership, at this tournament, I think he's honestly the best DraftKings play. I really do, all things considered. The fact that he has the PMAM group, the fact that he has the best, like some of the best course history here. He's won this tournament, he's finished runner-up twice. He plays long course as well. The course has been extended. He's been nailing the ball tee to green. He's putting well. His confidence seems to be back. He's walking the walk. I've said that I think DJ is going to have a big year. I'm going to stand by that. So enough talk about DJ. Bet him, number one DraftKings play for me. you'll be my top of my pyramid. Next guy, I bet a future on, Morikawa. And there's two things. So he's PMA. I like my Morikawa bet because I got him at like 25-1. And he's like 20-1 now. And I was talking to people and, you know, about my picks, and I was saying like, I don't know if I'd tell people to bet Morikawa now. And when I was saying that, he was at like 12, he'd gotten all the way down to like 12-1. Now his form isn't there. He's back down to 20. He doesn't model out like incredibly well. He's got like, I think it's two top 25s. Maybe two top 20s, honestly. One top 20. 18th. He finished 18th, but he's made the cut twice. 8 rounds, 4 under par. So, like, he's, like, not, like, in the greatest form. He's not, like, the greatest course history here, but, like, it's also his third time coming, and I think this is the more times you go to Augusta, people say course history here matter a lot. I think course history does matter, but I also think if you've qualified for 3 Masters that you're a better player than you were when you qualified for it the first time. So like that can't be necessarily measured. Like people like look at the course and they're like, oh, it's course history. That's why they play here well. But also they're better golfers. I think people forget that sometimes. I do think there is a higher premium on course history here, but it is something to think about, right? Like, oh, this guy's course history is so good. Well, yeah, he's, you know, John Rahm, right? This guy's course history is so good. Well, yeah, I mean, he's qualified for the Masters 5 straight years. He's made the cut 5 times, and every time he's playing it better. Like, so again, just something to think about when you're constructing things here. So the second favorite bet of mine. Oh, so the Morikawa. I don't think I got to my point on Morikawa, but I like the fact that he's not one of my favorite bets right now. When I made the bet a while ago, he was. I thought going into this year he was going to win the Masters. I still think he can win the Masters. I would be playing him heavily in DraftKings, sub 10% ownership. Colin Morikawa. At a major, I don't give a flying fuck to a certain extent about some of these players, some of the form, whatever. Like Colin is, what is he, top 20 in the model? Probably 23rd in the model. I ran the Sims, 2% chance of winning. Not bad. Nobody like Colin at the Open. What was the narrative? He can't win here. He can't do this. He's out of form. He's never played, you know, and then he goes out at 55-1 and he wins. I like the fact that there's no attention on Colin right now. I like the fact that nobody's talking about him. I like the fact that he wins, like he's played in like 8 majors and won 2 of them. I'm going to bet Colin at majors. I have principles, and there are 2 principles that I have with betting guys outright. And it's always bet Colin at a major, and it's always bet Brooks at a major. And it's normally always bet Tiger at a major as well, but we'll get into that. So I have Colin. I like Colin. I wouldn't say he's one of my favorites. Zalatoris. I love Zalatoris. And I just like it because his line, he's 35-1. I know he hasn't won on tour, but he's been so close so many times. He finished 2nd here last year, his first time playing this course. Nails the ball tee to green. Putter seems to be coming around. Switched up his putting a little bit. They added a little bit of a weight to the back of his putter, and he looks like just a new person on the green. So I am going to stick with Zalatoris. Scheffler and Cam Smith I took. I don't like the fact that they're teeing off in the PM and the AM, but in terms of guys and how they're playing and form, they're like 2 of the best right now. Cam Smith's probably going to be the chalkiest guy on DraftKings, or one of the chalkiest guys on DraftKings, and I don't know if I'm going to get to him or not because of the PM-AM thing. He tees off in the AM. So those are the guys I bet outright. Oh, and Cam Young was my long shot. I bet Cam Young. Also, now he's teeing off in the AM, PM. Taking him first round leader, like that a lot. So I'd have him first round leader. I have him to win. He's my long shot this week. And yeah, that's it for outright. So now the more important stuff, the DFS world. So let's just quickly. You've seen the board by now. You know who's priced where. But I'm gonna give my thoughts on some of the most interesting, what I think are the interesting guys. And one more thing before going into the lineup. So one thing I saw, this was probably the coolest thing I've seen on Twitter this week in regards to Masters content. Somebody tweeted out the millionaire maker lineups and their ownership totals for all of the majors for like the past like 5 years. And what stuck out, and I think the people that looked at this and other people, I've heard a few other people talk about this on their shows this week, is that the chalk at the Masters, chalkier lineups in the Millionaire Maker have won. Over, like, one of the lineups was over, like, 115% ownership, which is insane. Typically, I target 90% ownership. I think I've talked about that before, total lineup ownership. I'll still look to do the same this week, because I think if you look over the other years, it was like 86, whatever. But it was relative to the other big tournaments where you look at the total chalk of the lineup, nowhere close. Like the Masters, the chalk hits harder in a good way than it does at any other tournament. And here's part of this is like something to think about as well. Masters is a shorter field, right? There's 100 people or 90 to 100. I think there's like 92 this year. And if you look at the bottom of the field, Laird Sheppard, Aaron Jarvis, Austin Greaser, Stuart Hagstead, James Piatt. I won't even count, can I? Vijay, Sandy Lyle, Larry Mize, Jose Maria Azabala, Bernard Langer, Fred Couples, Mike Weir, Patrick Harrington, but like Patrick Harrington finished fourth at the PGA, so I won't count him. Keita Nakamura, that's another. So you have like 15 guys, and look, anybody can win any tournament or whatever. 15 guys that, in my mind, basically can't win this tournament. So you take an 100, and this is to the point of why the chalk prevails here. So you take an 100-person field, which is short to begin with, versus the other majors. Typically, they're 150, and I have 92 golfers in this field right now. 91 golfers in this field. So 15 out. That leaves 75, give or take. So you're choosing between 75 golfers, right? And everybody's running the same models for most weeks, but this week even more so, right? The models people are running are going to be very similar. People are going to be looking at a lot of the same things. And because of that, you know, you have a shorter field, you have this, you know, a lot of people have data now. You like to think that it makes sense, I guess, is what I'm saying. And why I'm saying all this is typically I'm terrified of playing a guy who's X percent owned, you know, because this, that, or the other reason. And this is a week where I think you don't need to be as afraid of the chalk as you normally are. So I still think you want to target under 90% ownership lineups, total ownership. But however you get there and decide to get there with your player combinations, shouldn't be something like terrible to you should be worried about terribly. So let's talk about the board and who we like here. So Scotty is the highest priced at 11. Rom, DJ, JT, Colin, Victor, Rory is the 10 to 11 range. In that range, Scotty is the only one teeing off in the AM, and his ownership is 11, projected to be 11%. It was 14 before tee times came out, so it's trending negatively. As of yesterday, it was 14. As of today, it's 9. I have it projected being 11. I do a few different things to project where I think it will end up being. But interesting, right, that Scotty's going to get to sub 10, and I mentioned the wave advantage. But there's a few guys that, even in the players I played, and end up not being, I mean, like JT made the cut, but I played him regardless of what the wave advantage told me. And there's not many guys I say I would do that with this week, but I don't think the it looks as severe as it was at the players. So if they're if and Scottie Scheffler slash Cam Smith, the two guys I was going to mention here, and JT, I guess you could say. Oh, JT is AM PM as well. Sorry. Where I don't necessarily worry as much. It's more down the board, right? Like, Scottie Scheffler plays tough conditions well. So if you want to play him, I don't worry about playing him in the AM-PM wave as much as I worry about... Here's an example. Jason... yeah, I wouldn't even play him anyway. What is a good one? Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of different guys I could talk about, like Berger, right? I mean, like, I might have played him if he was in the better way. I mean, Berger, I still might. This is just a bad example. I should just cut this out of the. I don't edit any of this. This is just bad content right now. But Siwoo Kim, here's an example. Sorry, he's models out well, but he's playing in the shittier group. And I can go to a guy like Robert McIntyre, models out just as well, who plays in this course just as well, who less owned and is going off in the PM and then the AM. So I'd rather pivot down low to my theory about PM AM than up top. So point being, I mean, if you talked to me last night when I went to bed and said 14% Scotty, I was all out on him. It's 11% maybe, and he's trending downward. Might be back in. Not going to be heavy on him regardless. Rahm I'm in on. DJ I'm in on. I'm out on JT. I'm terrified of some of these guys. Ooh. Damn. Okay. Washout today. This is horrible for me. My allergies are brutal, but I'm fighting through it for you guys. So, like, this is a week where, like, you have to fade guys. Like, you have to. And you're not going to be happy. you're going to be terrified of the guys you fade. But, like, you have to cross guys off the list. You can't play every guy. The best guys in the world are playing in this. So many guys are going to model out well. You have to make your decisions. So, again, I'm favoring PM AM. As of right now, I have, like, two guys in the AM I'm going to play. Maybe three. I'm not just fully decided on, but I've already bet him. So in that range, before we move on, I'm going to do a few lineups with Colin and Victor, which projects to be 18% ownership between those two. 18%. It looks like the combo people are looking to do are JT and Rahm, which is 39% ownership. Now just think about this. Just think about this for the DFS perspective. You can play JT and Rahm. You play JT and Mon, who model out well, who have the course history, who everyone else is gonna be playing, who, other than Rahm winning the US Open, they have, and JT winning the Players, which are two massive tournaments last year, have not won. Colin and Victor have won multiple times since they've won those tournaments. Is what I'm saying. So I can do a combo of Rahm and JT for, again, 39% ownership. So guys who've won less tournaments over the past year for 39% ownership and more expensive, or Colin and Victor won more tournaments, cheaper and lower ownership. And that's where you have to take your stances, right? I think that ball striking is going to play a premium this week, and that's just, I hate when people say that, because I think ball striking plays a premium every week. But I think that, like, people who are worried about around the green type of stuff with Colin and Victor, I think that they hit the ball so well, they're going to be in better positions than most of the other guys. And that's not to say they're not going to have to hit shots around the green. They are, but they'll have to hit less, I think, if they're playing their games. And for half the ownership, less price, same win equity in my mind, if not more, I love it. So the guys I'm peppering right now are DJ, Rom, Colin, Victor, Rory. I don't want to play Rory, but I have principles, remember? Remember? And he's sub 12, ownership 11.5. He modeled out second for me. Fuck. He's got great course history here. It's, you know, he hasn't won the green jacket. It's the last of the majors. He's PMAM. You think this is going to be a lower scoring tournament. I just think Rory's won me a lot of money, and he's one of the most frustrating guys to decide this for. But I think that all things considered, I think he's worth the play this week at 11%. 11% ownership. So let's get into the 9Ks. Cam Smith, Jordan, Xander, Patrick, Brooks, Hideki, Zalatoris, Bryson, Berger. Cam Smith terrifies me, but he's 24, he's 23% ownership. He's going to be the chalk, maybe the chalkiest guy of the week. Again, I said I'm not afraid of chalk. This chalk scares me a little bit, but everything about Cam Smith makes sense this week, and he's 9,900. I've heard people say, like, oh, he's not priced. Like, he's, like, not, like, if he was priced lower, I would have taken him. Like, why, how would he have been priced lower? Like, the guy is one of them players. He's priced below 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 guys, and he's, like, the fourth favorite to win the tournament. So it's a misprice, in my mind, for DraftKings, for a guy who plays this tournament extremely well, who just won the Players, who putts incredibly well, who gets up and down from everywhere, who plays tough conditions well. The only thing that scares me is Cam Smith, and this scares me with Scheffler as well, and all of these guys, is this is getting through Friday. And at the Players, so many guys who are fucking unbelievable players, who are guys that I played because I thought, like, oh, it doesn't matter, they can get through the weather, just didn't. So I think I'm going to play Cam, and I think I'm going to play Scheffler. Those will probably be the only two guys in the AM, PM. I don't want to play JT. I want to play JT, but I don't want to play JT. It's tough for me. And I have to make decisions. So as of right now, I don't have JT. I don't have Cam. And I don't have Scheffler in any lineups. But I bet two of those three guys. And I'm going to try to get Scheffler and Cam maybe in a few lineups. Because I feel like those are two guys that if I leave out and they win, I'm going to be like, what was I doing? So 9Ks, Cam. Again, I like Cam, but I don't like his chalk. A lot of people like Cam. Spieth at 10% ownership for $100 less. Spieth at 10% ownership for $100 left. Who's got arguably the best course history at the Masters. People who model and run stats are gonna say, like, ah, course history doesn't matter. Like, what do you mean? But is it not something to say that, like, every time this guy shows up here, he plays well? So listen, look at these stats. 32 rounds played, 8 tournaments entered, 8 cuts made, 20 rounds under par, 20 out of 32. Low round 64. Pretty sure that's a course record. 70.44 scoring average. 5,261,800 in total winning money here. 8 showings, 8 cuts made, 6 top 20s, 5 top 10s with a win and a runner-up. Only thing that scares me about Spieth right now is I watched him last week at I've watched him the last few weeks. And he's hitting the ball, like, really well. And normally, like, it's off the tee and, like, approach stuff that worries me with Spieth. And his putting's, like, great. His putting, he looks lost. It's, like he's missing everything from, like, 3 feet. He doesn't putt well at the Masters. So that's the one thing that scares me, right? Like, oh, like, he's got good course history. He's just going to come back here and, like, putt well. Well, he loses strokes putting here and historically wins, like, gains strokes at most other courses. So that's what scares me. He's losing strokes putting. He's coming back to a course he plays well, but he doesn't putt at well. So he's and the worst part of his game right now is putting. So I can't stop looking at the 10%. He's PMAM. is Cam Smith twice as likely to win this tournament in worse conditions and play in worse conditions than Spieth is playing in better conditions? And of course, where Spieth is better than Cam Smith, I don't know. I don't know. They're going to be two guys that are tough to get away from. So are these two, Xander and Cantlay. Cantlay, I'm not going to play. I'm not going to. I'm not going to play right now. They're both PMAM. They both model out well. They both play the Masters well. Both pretty low ownership. I'm going to play one of the two. I haven't decided yet. Brooks, I'm going to play at 11%. Think he's back in form. Think he looks good. Think he has win equity. Zalatoris, we're playing at 92. Come on now. Rather than go through everybody, because I've already done 40 minutes here, I'm just going to talk about my favorite guys in the other ranges. So let's go to the 8K range. 8K, I like Hatton. I like Hatton and M. In 800. Or 8,000, excuse me. 7,000. This is an interesting range. It's a large range. Henley, I like. I don't like Henley to, like, win, but he just finishes well at tournaments. He models out well everywhere because he's great tee to green. He, like, doesn't really do anything that bad. He's just, like, doesn't really close. There's my take on Henley. So I like Henley. I mean, Sergio, just like just 7%. Sergio PMM is just staring at me, but I'm like, I don't think I'm going to do it. Fitzpatrick, I'm going to play. I'm going to eat the chalk on Fitzpatrick. I think if the course is playing tough, he went like, this is perfect for him. I think it's perfect for him. He's going to play like a lower scoring Masters in terms of this winning score is going to be below 10 under is great for Matt Fitzpatrick. He finished like top 10 at the one Will it won, which was a low scoring one. So I like that as well. Reed, I like. I just do. I don't know why. I mean, he took down Rahm like so casually. And nobody, I feel like nobody's talking about Reed. And a tough condition course, I think that's perfect for Reed. I'm going to play Cam Young even though he's AM PM. Models out so well. McIntyre I'm playing. And then Thomas Peters is my 6K play. And I don't love it. Because he was 7% ownership 2 days ago. He's 9% this morning. He's projected 8.5. And I have like a rule of like the Turtle PGA DFS rules where I don't play chalk, 6K chalk over 10%. But Peters has so much upside. It's going to be boom or bust. He kills the ball. He's finished fourth here. He's finished well at majors. He's won a tournament or two this year. Like, I want win equity, right? And I think he has it in the 6K range, which is rare. So I think I'm going to eat the chalk there. My potential pivot's Varner or probably Varner. I was going to say Straka, but he's AMPM. Yeah. I'm extremely excited for this week. I'm extremely excited. I think that I will close by... Close by just saying, if Tiger Woods takes all my money this week, I will be it's the only person I'll be happy. I'm not going to play him. People are going to say, oh, you know, it's going to be tougher, which is lower scoring, which is going to be tougher conditions, windier, whatever, which is going to be good for him, which I totally agree with. That is good for him. But he's also not good for him. It's good for him in the sense that people not shooting 15 under is going to be good for Tiger because he can... He's a conservative golfer. Like, people don't want to say that, but he is. And he can just outsmart people, keep the ball, you know, in the places he needs to not miss where he needs to not miss. And people have been saying he's playing pretty well. So Yeah, we'll see. We'll see what happens. I mean, Tiger, to me, I have to fade. I'm sorry. Until I see him on Friday, I will, if I'm gonna hop on Tiger, I will need to do it, need to be watching him play in the tough conditions. So I also don't think you should, like, if you see Tiger playing well after the first round, do not bet Tiger after the first round. I really think you have to wait till he gets through Friday, and that's when I would hop on. I don't think it's going to be too late either. I think it's going to be a condensed leaderboard. I think there's going to be a lot of guys that can win, and a lot of guys' odds are going to reflect that. So I'll leave you all with that. Let's go low this week. Let's win $1 million this week. DJ wins this week. I'm a very happy person. And that's it. Chalk dirty to me. Feel free to send me some your favorite plays. We've got RBC Heritage next week. Not to look ahead to that, but I'm gonna be there next Sunday, so I'll be on grounds, which I'm excited about. But I'm more excited to watch, from my couch this week. But I'll be heading down south this week, to South Carolina, to Hilton Head, and watching down there. And to everybody out there, happy Masters week. Christmas in April, as I like to call it. And we'll talk next week for the RBC Heritage.
Peace.